Everybody ready?
Ready?
Yeah.
All right, listen.
It's your weekend show.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
With Bob Biermann.
It's great.
And welcome to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. I'm so glad you're taking some time from your busy weekend schedule to spend it with me. I know there are a lot of things you can do on any given weekend. You can enjoy the time off if you work a schedule that is 5 days a week and you enjoy your weekend. There are a lot of other things competing for your time, and it means a lot to me that you would use some of that time over your weekend to listen to this program. This program is a labor of love. We started it a little over 2.5 years ago, and I was thinking this morning as I was preparing for this program today, some of the things that we've talked about, some of the things that we've seen, and some of the hopes and aspirations we've had along the way. And there have been so many of them. I'm so excited about the opportunities that we get each and every week. You know, we talked about one of the stations that carries this program. It's the Voice of Hope. The Voice of Hope is located in Zambia, in the eastern part of Africa. And that station, with all its power, covers that entire continent up into the Middle East and even into Europe. It can be heard occasionally here in the United States. And I want to thank Ray Robinson in particular that made it possible for this program to have that kind of a global outreach in another part of the world. And I know, and I hear about this often, about the number of people that listen to the Voice of Hope. I may not hear from many of them because they don't have internet access, or that it's just so difficult for them to send any kind of correspondence my way. But we hear from the station about those that know about the program. I was really humbled a little bit that one of my listeners on my website, yourweekendshow.com, saw about the Voice of Hope in Africa and gave them a donation. And I'm so proud of my listeners for supporting the missionary outreach of the Voice of Hope in Africa. And in fact, I want to take a little time. I don't normally do this, and I haven't done it in the past, too. When it comes to missionary radio, it's something that I still truly, truly believe in. I've been in the radio business over 40 years. Yes, I understand the new online radio world that's out there, and everybody being connected by the smartphone and what's called the Internet of Things. You know, we're going to have toasters that are going to be connected online on your Wi-Fi network. I don't know why, but before long, your toaster will talk to your phone. I don't see any particular great benefit. It is kind of neat, but what does it really accomplish in the grand scheme of things? I see so many ministries pulling away from conventional television and radio, thinking that online will reach the entire world. No, it will not. I've told you this so many times before. You know, only 40% of the world's population have any kind of decent potential for being online. So you're discounting around 60% of the world's population when you think that the internet can reach all. And the other problem with the internet, it's a great tool, and I use it. The program is heard by a number of people from various podcasting sites and from our website, but it's not the primary delivery of this program. This program is still primarily a terrestrial radio outreach. And the biggest problem I see with the internet in times of crisis, let me give you an example. Where I live at in North Georgia, not long ago, we had a serious hurricane up here in Georgia. Now, the winds were not in the hundreds of miles an hour. They were 50 and 60 miles an hour with tremendously heavy rain. And where I live, there's a lot of trees, and trees were falling down left and right, took out the power for over a week. And as I record the program today, this week, prior to the weekend, prior to the 30th of September, I still have zero internet service or cell phone service where I'm living at. And so I am disconnected. If your ministry or your program is online, I can't hear it. I'm not going to be able to hear it. And they could be that way for a substantial amount of time. Look at Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico's infrastructure has been pretty well devastated. How many people in Puerto Rico are online today to get their weather, to get their news? What news and information they will get will come by conventional radio to battery-powered receivers all over that island. Parts of Florida are in the same boat. Areas of devastation, the likes they haven't seen in a long time. And as far as getting back online, that's the least of your worries when you have no electricity or running water. And you're trying to get news and information. So the power of terrestrial radio is still there. And I don't see any major change down the line that's going to suddenly make it disappear off the face of the earth. I've heard some ministries and so-called experts say some of the most foolish things. Oh, they're going to get rid of FM radio and give all that spectrum to Wi-Fi. It's not going to happen. Number one, Wi-Fi won't work on a VHF frequency that low. The bandwidth required exceeds the entire FM band for just one Wi-Fi channel. So there's a lot of misinformation on a technical level out there regarding what direction some countries are going. They'll see countries like Norway and some other European countries moving toward digital radio and shutting off analog FM. Well, it's still radio. Think about that. It's still radio, just a modification of the platform. As different as AM is from FM, digital is just a differing platform for single directional radio, using that same spectrum like a radio station, like it was before, with better audio quality and more efficiency. So saying that FM radio is going away is not true. It's just changing the platform. And those nations in Europe have been gearing up for this for many, many years. So it's not a great overnight surprise that, oh, the internet took over. No. It's just that government-run radio stations have been building this new FM digital infrastructure for years. And they've been running side by side, simulcasting the same programming. And as certain cities, especially in Norway with the mountains and everything else, all these lower powered transmitters do a better job of filling in the gaps in the cities, which would not occur as readily with conventional analog FM. It's still an FM type frequency. It's just digitally modulated is the only difference. So once again, I've heard those errors coming out of so-called newsworthy ministries telling you all you need to know about what's online and how all this online is going to just decimate in no time the conventional industry. And I just don't see it happening. You know, I get a kick out of some of the younger people that are discovering here in the United States what's called a little outside antenna, which can pull in free television. They've been raised in an environment where they've only known cable and internet in their house that you pay for. And the idea of getting free television is news to them. They thought you had to pay for all your content somehow, some way. So it's a great life hack is the term they would use today, that suddenly we can get television and many channels for free. And we don't even have to be connected to the internet to do it. It's amazing. It's about as amazing as those first broadcasts of television being received over the air in 1948. And a lot of people had a hard time fathoming the fact they can now see pictures flying through the air. It's an amazing thing. Technology will always move forward, and it will adapt. It will change. The concept of radio will always be around. Radio has gone through transformation since its very early days went in what we call the golden age of radio, where you had dramas and entertainment programs and musical programs, much like television became in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Radio was that single point of entertainment. And as television took radio's place in that type of format, the radio station simply adapted to become the soundtrack of your life, the music of your life, your news and information at the push of a button, making it easy as you travel. It's kind of hard to watch a television when you're driving a car, so the idea of the audio playing is still a very viable option. As we move forward in time, there are so many things we do in our life activities where we can't keep our eyeballs on a screen, and we can only deal with what we can hear. And so radio will always have a place. Now, getting back to missionary radio, as I was saying at the just a few minutes ago, it is stations like the Voice of Hope in Zambia that are giving news and information, and most importantly, the good news of the gospel being spread over multiplied millions of people that can hear their broadcast each and every day. And I'm just humbled to be a small part with a program on that station on two different frequencies, and I'm just amazed that so many people in a place I've never been can hear the sound of my voice today on the Voice of Hope. If you get a chance to go to our website, yourweekendtoshow.com, that's yourweekendtoshow.com. If you have internet access, remember, a lot of people don't, and I understand that. But for those that listen in the States, go to our webpage. And if you look on the information on the How to Listen page, you'll see a logo for the Voice of Hope. And I would encourage you to click that logo and learn about their incredibly growing ministry, reaching those places in the world that oftentimes we forget and ignore. You know, missionaries and the whole concept is to spread the good news to every person, not just some people, but to every nation and tribe. And the Voice of Hope is one of those that I wholeheartedly endorse and wholeheartedly support. And I'm looking forward to some of the work they're doing with their station in California, KVOH, which is a shortwave facility up near Simi Valley in the Los Angeles area. And hopefully their new transmitter will be online and adding additional time that can be reaching around the Western Hemisphere. And I'm hoping and praying to be a part of that when that day comes. So I encourage you to take a little time and check out the Voice of Hope. Well, I've ranted and raved on technology a little bit, and I know I don't normally do that too often, but it just goes without saying that there's so many ministries out there that are giving misinformation, especially in areas of technology. And it's bad enough they get a lot of news stories wrong. It's bad enough we have ministries that can't figure out, they're never going to figure out the end of time. There's some of those out there that are still reeling from their misprediction of last weekend being the end of the world. And I'll touch on that just a little bit later in the program. I don't want to belabor that topic too much. We discussed it at length last week, and I really don't need to go too heavily into it, but there's some things about it I'd like you to understand. You know, there's so many ministries that I really believe they claim to be following, and I'm being very cautious in how I choose my words, because I never want to be considered one that is dismissing or insulting or belittling the power of God's Holy Spirit. But I have to wonder at times when I've dealt with ministries and listened to some in the past where the Holy Spirit is guiding and directing them, so they claim, And one day they're going in this direction, and the next day they're canceling that and going in another direction, and then they change their mind again and go into a third direction, a fourth, a fifth. And they're giving information about things that is never, that oftentimes is not even accurate. And yet they want to be known. They want to be known as, you know, the reliable source, yet their own reliability and dependability and their candor is severely lacking. You know, I really get troubled, and I can think of a number of ministries that are coming to my mind that I've dealt with over the years, and where they raise money for these so-called projects that God has gloriously opened a door to them, and the truth is they never follow through, but they've raised sufficient dollars to do projects, and then they don't follow through. And that to me is very troubling. You know, I'm thinking of a time about a year and a half, not quite 2 years ago. I stood in a place, and I'm not going to mention where, but it was a place that a wonderful ministry could have been launched. And in this day and age, with the things that have happened in recent months, would be such a vital link to so many people. And it's not there. It's not there. After years and years of saying it'll be doing what it's supposed to be doing in a month or two, or 6 months from now, or 6 weeks from now, here we are 4 years going on 5 years later, and nothing tangible has been done. You know, if you listen to a ministry and they are asking you to support them, and they're presenting to you a vision, and they're raising things toward that vision and don't follow through, I would be a little concerned, in all honesty. I really would. I'd be a little bit concerned. It's amazing how some ministries, we're going to do this. No, we're going to do that. Oh, wait a minute. We're going to do something. Sorry about that. We're going to go in this direction now. Well, forget that. We're going to do this instead. Oh, our launch date will be, well, we're going to push it back a few more months. We were doing it. We're building it. And all of a sudden, we needed more money. We didn't really count on what the true expense was going to be. And I'm reminded of what Jesus says in the Bible. You know, about the man that decided to build a tower. And he failed to count the cost, and he got started on the project, and he ran out of money. And people looked at him and said, he didn't count the cost. He really doesn't know what he's doing. And I see a lot of ministries in that direction. This program is very simple. We come on the air, and we talk about life, the life experience we go through. We may make some commentary on some news items that are out there, and I have one that I'd like to touch on a little bit. Whether I get to it or not this week remains to be seen. It's really not that vital. But, you know, we do this program as an encouragement, and I just hope that I share information with you and maybe some thought processes you didn't have before, maybe a new way of thinking, adding some clarity. I just try to call it as I see it. I'm not a great expert on everything. I've just lived long enough, and I've been in the industry of communication long enough to understand its importance. Right now, I really believe that the Christian radio stations in those places around the world that are going through difficult times can really step up to the plate and really do more to provide vital, life-saving information. And you know something else about radio that's different than the internet? International radio in particular, like shortwave, it can cross international borders. There are places in this world that you cannot get any kind of honest news or information or even Christian programming. It is blocked. It is just forbidden. You can't access it. And if you are accessing it and caught, it can cost you dearly. But those radio waves that leave from a transmitter site in Okeechobee, Florida, Simi Valley, California, in Zambia, in the eastern part of Africa, and other locations and other stations, they can reach into places, and it's a one-way connection, and nobody knows you're listening. And there's no way they can filter out unless they attempt to jam that frequency, and then these stations can change frequency, and we can play the cat-and-mouse game like we did in the 50s and 60s and 70s during the Cold War, with shortwave in particular. This program can be heard in Cuba by those that speak English. This program can be heard all across Western Europe, even into Eastern Europe, into the Middle East, a very volatile part of the world, without filtering, without anything being taken away. This program can be heard by many, many people. So the power of shortwave is still there. And one last thought as I think of the devastation of Hurricane Maria in particular as it came across the beautiful island of Puerto Rico. And I've been to Puerto Rico and spent some time there actually working on a radio station, an upgrade. And I found it to be one of the most beautiful locations on God's earth. From the North Shore at San Juan across the beautiful mountains and down to the southern coast. It is an incredibly delightful, beautiful place. And right now, as we broadcast today on this weekend, pretty much Puerto Rico's infrastructure is demolished. They have no electricity, no running water. Phone service is gone. Forget the internet. That's the least of their worries right now. And hopefully radio can be a life link to those individuals to give them the information they need as they try to gradually come out from beneath the rubble and rebuild their lives. You know, we've talked early on in this program about what's called an EMP, electromagnetic pulse attack. And I'm going to share what I shared maybe a couple of years ago at the beginning of this program in its early days. An EMP strike is something they figured out in the late 1940s, I think it was, when they were doing an atomic test out in the Pacific, a few hundred miles away from Hawaii. And they wanted to test the detonation in the air of one of the newer bombs that was, you know, fairly powerful. And this bomb went up and it exploded, and they discovered an interesting byproduct they didn't count on. In Honolulu, a lot of electronic devices broke. Light bulbs burnt out. Traffic signals stopped. And it was because of this electromagnetic pulse. So they knew about this in the 1940s. And you can bet the Soviet Union and China and anybody else that's playing in the nuclear game has been for all these probably almost 70 years trying to exploit this phenomena to make it really a potent weapon. Can you imagine a single bomb being detonated at a specific height above the ground that could wipe out the power grid, kind of like Puerto Rico is today, take down communications and internet like Puerto Rico is today, and pretty well shut down your economy and your ability to even find food? How would we survive in a nation where all communications is interrupted and there is no electricity, in many places no running water, and it could be that way for weeks, months, even years? And to think that, you know, one of these nuclear devices could pretty well take down the power grid in a large section of our nation, the United States, and not for a day or two. We may be talking months or longer. So that's something to think about. The power of terrestrial radio is still there. You know, generators, and we've experimented with this when I was working at WRMI, can easily run transmitters of varying power levels that can reach out hundreds and even thousands of miles with vital news and information. You know, I'm so proud to be in the radio industry. I've seen some good changes. I've seen some bad changes, especially with some of the corporate management structures that bought up so many radio stations and are so imperiled by debt, they really can't deliver a decent product anymore. But I think of many of the locally owned radio stations around the country that provide such a vital service of local news, information, and weather, and things you really need to know about in your community. And they can do it instantaneously and deliver it to you immediately as needed. I'm proud to be a part of that industry of radio. It's been my life. I know a lot about the internet. I've been dealing with computers since the 1970s and 80s and early networks and internet. I've been around it for quite a while. And I see its good side. I see its efficiency. I see what it can do positively. But I wouldn't stake everything and put all my eggs in one little internet basket. Because if you do, you could be very sorely disappointed if you don't have a backup plan. Well, I've ranted and raved enough on the first part of this program. This is your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. Visit our website when you get a chance, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. Hey, and why not like us on Facebook? Look for us at Your Weekend Show. If you make Your Weekend Show all one word, you'll find us on Facebook. It would mean the world to me if you go there. You can send an email from the website, leave me a message on Facebook, and I'll do my best to get back to you as quick as I can. Pray for this ministry as we are looking at some of the things we can do to make it better. And your suggestions are welcome. There's just a stirring in my heart that says there's some great days ahead, and just trying to find the path we need to be. I don't want to get away from the fundamental part of the program, the sharing and caring from the heart. I think that'll always be a vital link that you and I have. But maybe some additional news and information. What can I do to help you? What would be something you'd like to see? Let me know by visiting the website, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. Or find us on Facebook at Your Weekend Show.
Back through the years, I go wandering once again. Back to the seasons of my youth. I recall a box of rags that someone gave us, and how my mama put the rags to use. There were rags of many colors, but every piece was small, and I didn't have a coat, and it was way down in the fall. Mama sewed the rags together, so in every piece with love, she made my coat of many colors that I was so proud of. As she sewed, she told a story from the Bible she had read about a coat of many colors Joseph wore, and then she said, perhaps this coat will bring you good luck and happiness. And I just couldn't wait to wear it, and Mama blessed it with a kiss. My coat of many colors that my mama made for me, made only from rags, but I wore it so proudly. Although we had no money, well, I was rich as I could be. In my coat of many colors my mama made for me. So with patches on my breeches and holes in both my shoes, in my coat of many colors I hurried off to school, just to find the others laughing and making fun of me. In my coat of many colors my mama made for me. And oh, I couldn't understand it, for I felt I was rich, and I told them all the love my mama sewed in every stitch. And I told them all the story mama told me why she sewed, and how my coat of many colors was worth more than all their clothes. But they didn't understand. as rich as I could be in my coat of many colors my mama made for me, made just for me.
Dolly Parton from 1971 and Coat of Many Colors. And I'll explain in just a moment why I shared that song at this particular time. I ran across an article just the other day, and it really kind of got under my skin a little bit. This particular article was about something that someone had been observing of late. And this person wrote that many of the LGBTQ activists within the church, if there can be such thing, have long produced a series of stories trying to twist the sexual orientation of biblical characters to fit their revisionist campaign. Now, when I read this one, I thought I'd heard them all. I mean, I've heard that Sodom and Gomorrah was all about a lack of hospitality. It was the latest twist. But this one was news to me. And I mean, I've been in ministry now for a number of years, and I've studied scripture for quite a long time. And this refers to the account in Genesis chapter 37. You know, remember Joseph and his brothers and his father Jacob that loved him so much and made him a coat of many colors? You know, his brothers did not like him. They resented the attention that their father gave him, and they decided to get rid of him, if you remember in the story, in the scripture. And so they sold him into slavery, took his coat of many colors and covered it with animal blood, and then took that back to their father to say that Joseph was killed by a wild beast. And if you remember later in the story, Joseph ends up in the land of Egypt and interprets the Pharaoh's dream about the seven fat calves and the seven lean and thin ones, and said to be 7 years of feast and 7 years of famine, and to be prepared. And that's exactly what they did. And because of Joseph's understanding and his ability to discern the Pharaoh's dream, he was made a ruler in the land of Egypt and took a place of great prominence. And I find the story interesting, especially when the brothers end up having to go to Egypt because the famine has hit their land as well, and they discover their brother who has the compassion of forgiving. Well, here's the new twist that they have now. The coat of many colors is really, are you ready for this? It's really a princess dress. Yeah, you heard me right. That's what some people are saying. It's a princess dress. And he's supposed to be a transgender character in the Bible. Now, do you buy that? I mean, this is the whole idea that because Joseph's father recognized that he was a transgender, he made him a coat of many colors. It makes no sense to me. You know, one of the things that is really troubling in the church today, and I use the term loosely when I say the church, there are many of these mainline Protestant churches that have literally walked away from faith and scripture and the teachings, the solid teachings of the church that go back 2,000 years with their clarity. They've walked away. They have found themselves another gospel. They are heaping to themselves these queer teachers to make them feel better about themselves. Let me tell you something. Christianity is not about your thoughts, your opinions, or your feelings. It's the relationship you develop with an almighty God, because we are all sinful and unclean by nature, and we are redeemed by Jesus' precious blood. And frankly, well, Satan has done a great job of breaking down these sexual boundaries. And I'm telling you, he's working so hard within the so-called church in erasing the concept of sin within the Western version of Christianity we find in the United States and Europe. No longer are we transformed by the cross of Christ. Now the emphasis is placed on our feelings and our self-identity. I'm telling you, Satan is hard at work in tearing down the church. These persuasive arguments by these revisionist sexual ethics. They're extending now beyond the secular culture. It's beyond the usual, what you would call, religious left in the world. It's working its way into the church. I'm telling you, this is where the world is heading. The church is becoming, these mainline churches are becoming unrecognizable. Their lampstand, as it says in the book of Revelation, has been taken from them. I remember having a meal recently with somebody that was raised in a solid Christian faith, but now is buying into all this new theology. It's all about me. I call it the first narcissistic church. It's all about me, my feelings, my identity. And we, instead of conforming to Christ, we are demanding Christ conform to us. When I come back, I want to share a message that I preached recently that covers a number of issues. I preached it at the Chapel of Sky Valley. You can find out about the Chapel of Sky Valley by going to skyvalleychapel.com. That's skyvalleychapel.com. That's where I am now, the senior pastor. And I would encourage you to go to the website. You can hear the messages that I preach each and every Sunday. And I'm going to share in just a moment one of those messages with you that I really believe is something we need to hear today. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Biermann.
The Voice of Hope 1287 is the only Christian radio station licensed in Israel. We're the only domestic radio station with international purpose, and we exist to be a support to the Christians of the entire Middle East region. We're also reaching out to those that have never heard the gospel, and we're broadcasting in Arabic and some English. We reach right into Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, Cyprus. At night, we reach into Turkey and Egypt with the gospel of Jesus, the gospel of hope. Many people have tried to do this over the years, and the doors were closed. And they said, oh, no, that's impossible. But when God is ready to do something, when he leads us to do something, he enables us to do something. And so it looks like we're the heroes, but we're really not. It's God. We take no credit for it other than that we obeyed him in all of these details.
I just wanted to take a moment to thank those at the Voice of Hope Israel, Los Angeles, and of course in Africa where this program is heard. Keep them in your prayers. Find out more about them from our website, yourweekendshow.com. They are truly, truly an impressive ministry, and I'm thankful to be a very small part. As I said before, I had a message that I shared with my congregation at the Chapel of Sky Valley, and I hope this message will have some meaning for you today. This was preached on the 24th of September, the day after the so-called special effect in the sky that was supposed to be the end of the earth.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to this time that we learn from your word, open our eyes that we might see, open our ears that we may hear, and our hearts to receive what you have for us. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Before I get started, I want to take just a little personal privilege here, if you don't mind. I thought about this the other day. This week in September is a strange time for me, and it has been for the last number of years. You know, it was exactly 13 years ago on this date, the 24th, that I gathered in a church to say goodbye to my first wife. And so this week always has a sense of emotion. And I can think of the challenges that it gave me in my ministry in those initial months and years after. I went through a period of time where I didn't want to do it anymore. I just was upset, mad, angry. I don't need this. I don't need this. But over time, God healed that part of me. And as As the psalmist David uses this term, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence. He said that in a time where he had grievously sinned against God and God's people. In my case, as I said that same prayer at one point, it was, Lord, I've ignored your work. I've been selfish. I've been hurting. But you've been there all the long. And now I'm back, have been for a number of years, and I thank God for the trials that he put us through. Today also being the 24th is another important thing. How many of you have been reading on the internet that the end of the world was supposed to happen yesterday? Yep. You know, I will tell you that for many, many years, I have had a deep interest in eschatology, the end time things. And I go back, way back, to the early 1970s when I first grabbed an interest in high school and in college about this topic. And I had to read every book I could find. The Late Great Planet Earth. Remember that book? And he said, 40 years is a generation. And they said, when Israel becomes a nation, in 40 years, that'll be a generation and Jesus will come back. So he was supposed to come back in 1988. And how these people are still around making more predictions is beyond me. There was a guy by the name of Ken Wisenit. I remember him quite well. He was a former NASA research scientist. And he wrote a book that became a real big buzz, especially in a lot of, in particular, Pentecostal and Baptist circles. It was called The 88 Reasons That Jesus Will Return in 1988, published in 1986. And that book sold and sold, and he was on a speaking tour for 2 years almost. And when 1989 rolled around, there was a great disappointment. But fear not, he had another book. He realized I made a mistake. So it was The 89 Reasons That Will Come in 89. And we never heard from him again. Harold Camping, who ran a great ministry called Family Radio, started in the 1950s with radio stations in New York City, Los Angeles, California, Oakland, California, major market cities. International shortwave reaching the globe. Twice that I know of, and I think someone said three times, tried to predict the date. The last time was 2012. It was going to be May 22nd or 27th of 2012. And he spent most of the ministry's money buying billboards all over the United States saying, the world will end, the rapture will occur on this date, in 2012, the Bible guarantees it. He has since passed away and his entire ministry has collapsed into nothing. There are people in the 1800s predicting that it would occur in 1819 or 1912. Go back over 2,000 years and all the date setters have been consistently wrong. Looking for that day of reckoning and that day of judgment. I even worked for a ministry for a while. I won't name it. And I finally figured out when I got on the inside of this ministry, you know, they kind of just see which way the wind is blowing today, and that must be what the Holy Spirit is saying to them. I remember in 2015, they had this prophetess guest as a guest on the telephone for an interview. And she said, you know, we have to have all of our preparations done by the end of August. That's August of 2015. Or it'll be everlastingly too late as the tribulation begins and you'll starve to death, you'll have no food, and your bank accounts are going to go. As we got into September, great revelation. This is just the bookend. This is the beginning of the beginning of the end. We have another year. And the new conspiracy was, it'll be the election in the United States. It'll be the downfall or the uptick or whatever it's going to be. And then that's come and gone. And then we went on to the eclipse Oh, yeah, there were people saying this eclipse back in August, this is a sign in the heavens from God. And yesterday was supposed to be some other sign of the woman giving birth and whatever. Why are we going to astrology to learn about the things of God? Why would God use something we understand, can see? Wouldn't he do something to confound us a little bit? A sign in the heaven we can't explain? What is that? I don't know. I mean, we knew to the second when the eclipse was coming to Sky Valley. We knew it was going to be 2:36 or whatever it was, and it would get dark. And in a minute and a half, it would start getting light again. What kind of a sign is that if we understand it? What kind of a sign are they? They said this one that's supposed to have occurred last night. Oh, it's a once in 7,000 year. Check with the New York Planetarium. You'll find out it's happened many, many times. Every planet has its orbit. Every solar system has its pattern. We know what that pattern is. And we can tell you that in 142 years, exactly where every planet will be and every star will be at any given time of the day. We can make up anything we want to make up by these things that we see. I do a radio program, and I had a lot of fun recording it this weekend. I called it my farewell show, saying it's going to be the 23rd, so I may not be here. I had a lot of fun with it. It is a Christian-oriented program, and I talked about this insanity that we see among some about being over-prepared. You know, there are those that are out there trying to prepare for a 7-year or 25-year tribulation to have enough food tucked away. You know, the Bible talked about the 10 virgins at the wedding feast. 5 were wise. They had a little extra oil. 5 were foolish. They didn't take any extra with them. And so when it got around midnight and the lamps of the 5 foolish ones are running out, they try to go back into town to buy some more oil. And during that time, the bridegroom came and they missed it. The Bible does not talk about the 15 virgins. In other words, the 5 that were prudent that had the extra oil, the 5 that were foolish, didn't have any. But he never talked about the 5 that went and got a tanker truck of oil to be ready. There comes a point of using common sense and being prudent. And that's what the Bible teaches us. Now today, if you go into the Old Testament lesson, I always get a kick out of this particular narrative. It comes after the famous thing we learned in Sunday school about Jonah and the big fish and the 3 days in the belly and all this and his disobedience. Quickly to understand it. Jonah's a prophet. And God says, I want you to deliver a message to Nineveh that I'm pretty well mad at them because they're disobedient, this and that and the other. And if they don't repent, I'm going to destroy the city. Well, Jonah goes, I don't even like Nineveh. I don't feel like I want to go. Hey, don't tell them anything. Just take them out. That's Jonah's attitude. I'm so mad at them anyway, I don't care. So he gets on a boat going the opposite direction. That's when God calls him back. And after 3 days, and whether it's a whale, a great fish prepared, whatever, he gets basically barfed out onto the shore at Nineveh. And you can imagine him getting out of that. Can you imagine seeing somebody coming out of a great fish into your city going, repent! Listen to what God has to say. You might listen. But once again, Jonah had this attitude that Nineveh deserves to get whatever they got coming to them. So he gave his message and then went off to the hills. And we pick up today as he's looking down, waiting for God to throw the fire, the brimstone, the floods, whatever he's going to do. I want a front row seat. Well, unfortunately for Jonah, Nineveh repented. And God decided to spare the city. Now, Jonah is mad. What do you mean you're going to spare the city? I thought you were mad at them. No, I called them to repentance and they repented. Now Jonah is mad enough where he wants to just die. Man, I can't get anything right. I don't know what I'm doing. I thought I was going to go there to watch that place go down because they earned it. God says, no, they repented. Let's hop to our gospel lesson briefly. Think about this. There are workmen that were out there first thing in the morning in the vineyard. And as the Bible said, they agreed to a wage, which would have been no problem had they come to the end of the day and got paid. It would have been just another day at work. But along the way, the guy that owned the field kept going back to town to see if there was anybody that wasn't working. So he got another group around lunchtime, another group in the afternoon, and then, you know, the last hour of the day, a few more show up. They all got paid the same thing. Boy, people grumbled about that. Wait a minute, I was here all day. I should get more. No, you agreed to work for the typical day's wage. You were happy with that. Basically, to be honest, it's the owner's money. He can do with it as he wants. And he did. You know, I learned something in that period of time that I was away from ministry. And I had to reevaluate and rethink, do I really want to do this any longer? And it came with a clear and resounding yes that I wanted to re-answer that call and go back to that point and stop being upset and looking at my predicament and the way I feel in my heart and my sorrow. I didn't need it anymore. God dealt with it. And there are a lot of precious memories of my early years of ministry. But I'm seeing now, because I've lived a life, that I have a more, shall I say, vital ministry. Having lived and been through some things, you begin to understand how this life plays out. There's a lot of things I have yet to learn. St. Paul goes, if it was up to me, I'd be with Jesus right now. I wouldn't even be on this earth. You know, Paul lived in an expectation that none of us live in. You know, we have it so easy we forget that he could be coming. You know, it wasn't the 23rd of September, but we need to understand something. The Bible is clear that the day will come. It will come. It'll catch us like a thief in the night, too, by the way. We'll have no warning. And St. Paul lived in this anticipation that it could happen in his lifetime. It's like, come on, Lord, bring it on. I'm ready to go. I've done what you've asked me to do. But Paul comes to this realization, like I did. But you know, if you still need me here, I'll stay here and I'll do your work. The Bible says, in many ways, work for the night is coming. Work for the night is coming. The day is going to come when we can work no more. One of my grandfather's favorite hymns. And he would sing it playing the piano. I could remember it from the time I was a young child, well into my teens, my 20s, my 30s, and even my 40s, when I first went into the ministry. Before my grandparents moved from their house and decided to part with their piano because they were getting up into their almost late 90s at that point. And the last time he ever played that piano, I'll never forget it, he had to play that favorite hymn. It's in the Lutheran hymnal. It's the last hymn in the book. It's called, I'm But a Stranger Here, Heaven Is My Home. He would play that from the time that man was in his 50s when I first really knew him growing up until his 90s. He always had that as the theme of his life. I'm but a stranger here. Heaven is my home. Yet he kept doing things for the cause of Christ and the kingdom of God as he felt led and called. And God gave both my grandparents an exceptionally long life. And I think that they're one of those that you can be counting on knowing they'll hear the words when that day comes. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. See, they're the ones that got on early in the day to work in the vineyard, but never grumbled about the pay. And it's because they didn't grumble. Like Jonah grumbled. Some of these workers grumbled. Because they didn't grumble, they just accepted the terms that God gave them willingly. Like St. Paul, if you want me to stay here, fine, I'll do it. We need to come to that point. We need to come to that point of willing to be obedient to what God calls us to do. Now, I talked about the end times prophets, spelled P-R-O-F-I-T, that are out there. And I did that for a purpose. We can get so, I see a danger in it when you get really into the next new book. I'm waiting to see what the new thing is going to be. You know, one of the great authors of one of the great videos that were up there just 2 weeks ago said, you know, this may just be the beginning of the beginning. I think I heard that 2 years ago from people. Yet people are gullible enough. You know, Jesus says in Matthew, I think it's Matthew 24, talking about the end times, he said, you know, you got to be careful about those who say, oh, here's the Christ. There's the Christ. He's in the desert. He's over the temple. No. You'll know the signs. You'll know it's getting closer. But no man knows. Even I, your Savior, don't know until my Father says, go and get your children. That's when he will know. When we spend a lot of time, and I'll just close on this thought, trying to chase after things that we don't need to worry about, we're not doing the things God called us to do. We are so busy looking for some special revelation from God. It's got to be in here somewhere. I know I've seen it. Oh, there's a verse. Now if I tie it to this verse, and then I tie it to this verse over in Daniel, oh, I got to figure it out. And then I just do the numbers of the verses. I've heard it all before. I've heard it all before. I told one person that was doing that, I said, you know, I can do the same thing. I can tie two verses of Scripture together and give you a powerful message right now. What's that? Judas hung himself. Go ye therefore do likewise. That's kind of what you have happen when you tie things out of their context. We are here for a purpose. I know I've been a little long today, and I kind of apologize, and I hope that you understand taking a little personal liberty and license today. But I love the job that I have, and I want to see this message from this church leave beyond these four walls. I think that is our number one calling. You know, when you hide your light under the bushel basket, nobody sees it. Let's take that light beyond the four walls of this church. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity, this time to share from your word. Lord, teach us not to be grumblers. Teach us, Lord, not to tell you what to do. Teach us to be obedient, willing, and thus happy and content, because we can find our contentment in you. Heavenly Father, may the words that we heard this day with our outward ears become grafted so much into our heart. For this I ask in Jesus' name. And all the people said, amen.
Once again, amen. Another weekend show is come and gone. Hard to believe this hour is already up. Go to our website, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. Or visit us on Facebook. Look for Your Weekend Show. Until next week, at this very same time, this is Bob Biermann wishing God's greatest blessings upon you.